Jenny Archer, who every year gives us a school so that theological reflection and dialogue could take place. This year, Goodridge Society could mobilize people from all denominations. And we will realize we have great Roman Catholics, Anglicans, Presbyterians. They all participate in dialogue and in interaction. That's what the theological society is all about. So you have a bridge and a vision. I remember going to do a comprehensive service at Codrington College, and we got speaking about theological education for the whole people of God. And he said, you know what, Lord, I am going to ask my board, and I am going to take it upon myself to initiate a program that will not only for the clergy, that's what I'm doing in Covington, but for the people of God. And why? The people of God are in the frontiers of mission. And they must be empowered. They must be facilitated to carry out that mission. That mission is the arena of the world. Theology comes alive in the world. And that's what our society is all about. We are enabling and facilitating persons of different faiths, different communities, different professions, in order to carry out the work of the church, the work of God, the mission of God in this part of God's kingdom. And so I want quickly to turn over to our panelists. We are fortunate to have Dr. Rock, who comes every year. And I think this is important that the principal of Codrington takes seriously all the principles from Sehon Goodridge, in the line, in the heritage, to come and participate in our theological program. Please give him a round of applause at this time. And then we have Everad Johnson. I used to be a colleague, and then I taught at John Miami. He used to be a lecturer in history and comparative religion and what have you. So as soon as I told him, I said, Everad, Dr. Everad, I want you to come and join a panel. And then we will discuss the future of Ecumenism in the Caribbean. And then my other colleague, Granado, Gerard Granado, no one to boast, but that guy directed his thesis at St. John Vianney. And so I have just a question now, but not more than that, we have been friends for many years. We participated in many programs. And in fact, we used to be reported as a few years ago when I was Associate General Secretary of the Caribbean Conference of Churches. And as soon as I couldn't be, today we are celebrating CCC Day. 40 years of ministry in this part of God's kingdom. Let's talk about it and let's see where we can go from there. So, Dr. Johnson and Dr. Granado. Everybody ought to get it. A little lady, you know, ask him to push on to get it. For the age in which he is, the lady theologian. So there are two lady theologians, one of these theologians, one so. Without any further ado, I am going to ask Dr. Everett is in the center, so I'm going to ask him to go as a center.
Just to get the panelists approval, recently we started to upload. If you notice on the back page, there's a list of the previous lecturers and we have started to put these on YouTube. It's taking a long time to edit from the evening prayer and to separate it into the lecture. So last year's lecture by Dr. Lashley, Marcus Lashley, who is also a psychologist, that is now on YouTube. So if you type see on Goodridge Theological Society, Solemn Hymn Song, you will see two things coming up. The service at Aperigo and the address. So this evening's panel discussion and your input as well will be made available via YouTube, and our local technician, Mr. Codrington himself, conflict with the name. He is Christopher Codrington, that's the
name. And he is diploma too.
So he's a diploma graduate, and the benefactor of the Codrington College was Christopher Codrington. So there you go. We have a name connection.
I want to start first of all with scripture. The point I want to make first of all is that the scriptural basis for humanism is critical and important for us. It is the basis from which our ecclesiology flows, our understanding of the church flows. And this comes from John's Gospel, John chapter 17, verse 21, where Jesus in the high priest prayer mentions that they all may be one. This has been translated into a document by one Holy Father at Unum Sinch. And that has become the basis for humanism, particularly from a Roman Catholic perspective. I don't want to suggest that if we are going to use a scriptural basis for humanism, then we have to move away from a dogmatic interpretation of scripture and engage in more ecumenical, interconfessional interpretation if we are truly going to move forward. The Theron Discourse is a prayer to God by Jesus for the salvation of the world. It's a prayer that acknowledges God's sovereignty, but also, more importantly, places God's power over all the dehumanizing powers and forces of this world. In the priestly high priestly prayer of Jesus in John's Gospel, we see God's act of redemption, God's grace in the man Jesus. We recognize there that unity is the nature of God in redemption activity. It is not a human activity. And therefore, the scriptural basis will say to us, if we are going to proceed towards humanism for the future, we have to recognize that it is a God-given gift, a God-given mandate. It is not based on our will and fancy. Ecumenism, unity, flows from the triune God, belongs to the triune God. And ecumenism modeled on that unity must be the basis of salvation, must be the basis for the church. Since the unity of the church is built on the unity of God as we see it in the Blessed Trinity, then we need to recognize that the prayer that Jesus made in the great high priestly prayer is not one to be answered. Interconfessional theologians would recognize that this prayer has already been answered. If the prayer is not being fulfilled, it is not that the unity of God is not being realized, but rather it is due to our own fallen nature, due to our sin, due to the fact that the church is not what Jesus intended it to be. We need to remember that the church is one because Christ is one. The prayer has been fulfilled in the church because the church is the temple of Jesus' body. It is where he is to be found. This is what one theologian, Charles H. Dodd, has reflected on John's Gospel, what he termed as realized eschatology. It has already been realized. And our attempts at human beings to make it a reality goes against what Holy Scripture says. As the basis for unity, we therefore have to recognize one faith, one Lord, one baptism, one church. In Christ, the divisions of mankind have set aside. And that is why Paul and other theologians in Holy Scripture can say that in Christ there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, there is neither Scythian nor barbarian, but rather all are one in Christ. The unity has already been established. If the unity has already been established, then why is it that we do not have unity? It is because we do not appear as one, not because of God's lack of grace, but because of our irresponsiveness as a church to God's redemptive work.